Okay, we're gonna get started and people might just roll in slowly from the waiting room, be a little late, but that is a-okay. Okay, so hello everyone. Welcome to the college, oh my goodness gracious, to the College to Nonprofit Career Panel hosted by the Association of Fundraising Professionals Collegiate Chapter of Iowa, also known as AFPCC. We are a student organization open to all undergraduate and graduate students. My name is Isabel Hauslog. I am a junior studying business analytics and marketing with a certificate in nonprofit leadership and philanthropy. I am the president of AFPCC and I will be moderating the event tonight. We are very fortunate to have three experienced nonprofit professionals with us this evening to give us insights into their careers, nonprofit careers we might consider, and how important soft skills are when it comes to being successful. Our panel this evening, we have Kristin Roberts, who is the president and CEO of United Way of East Central Iowa, Chris Doucet, of the director of Ace Hardware Foundation, and Michelle Cole, the director of external relations at Community Crisis Services and Food Bank. Thank you all for agreeing to be on this panel. We are very grateful to have you all here and to network and hear what all you have to say. And thank you to all the students in attendance. I know Zoom University has been hard and you're on Zoom calls all day. So thank you for taking time to come to yet another Zoom call. But hopefully this one will be more fun than any of your classes are. But we will have time towards the end of this evening to have you ask follow-up questions. You can submit them through the chat throughout the evening and we'll touch on those a little later after we wrap up with everything. And you can also raise your hand during the Q&A session and we will call on you and you can unmute yourself and ask your questions then. So we will now roll in to the questions for our panelists. We want to begin this evening by asking all of you about your nonprofit journey and what your career has looked like now at your current organization. So Kristin, would you like to start us off?
Sure. I don't know if Chris and Michelle feel this way, but I would say that I never was intending to go into fundraising whatsoever. I started off, actually, my degree is from Wartburg College, and I have a mass communications degree. It's focused in electronic media and public relations. And so I actually spent the first part of my career in local television news. And it was just kind of one of those things where after I had been in it for about 5 to 7 years, 7 years or so, I thought, you know what? I think I'm kind of done with this. Like, I want to move into something. And I always say that I just had someone take a chance on me. His name was Dick Meisterling and he was at Coe College. And thankfully I had been doing some volunteer work along the way that was also including a fundraising with nonprofits. And he just took a chance on me and said, hey, he saw the same skill set that you need in communications and relationship building between reporting and anchoring that you also need within fundraising. And so I was able to just use that and learn. And it's been kind of an amazing journey. So I've done academia and then I went into nonprofits. I've worked at small nonprofits. I've worked at Ronald McDonald House in Iowa City. I've gone to large nonprofits where I worked with Jennifer Vick at Four Oaks, the state's largest child welfare agency, $40 million budget for the whole organization. And then going to a healthcare system where I was able to dig in a little bit into the planned giving aspect and just expand my skill set. And I started at United Way of East Central Iowa about a year ago. It was February. And it is an amazing job in which you have the ability to reach a whole bunch of people. You get that opportunity to work with donors. You get the opportunity to work with those agencies that we partner with. We get to work and help people within our community, and along with then also working with volunteers, our board of directors. And it's just a little bit of everything about the job that I have right now, which makes it a lot of fun.
Thank you for letting us know a little bit about you and what you've been up to. Chris, we would love to hear about your journey and your current role.
Sure. So I am a proud Hawkeye and my degree was in the J school. There was not a certificate program at the time. And so my focus area was public relations. And I knew that I wanted to do something in healthcare. Hospitals have always been like my jam, which is weird, but I can't handle like blood and stuff. So I was like, what can I do in a hospital? And during my time at Iowa, I was heavily involved in the Greek system and it's in leadership roles, and became involved with Dance Marathon. And as part of one of my years that I served on the Family Relations Committee, we were required to volunteer on the oncology floor in the Children's Hospital. And that one hit me pretty hard. And I thought, this is something I'd love to do. So how do I marry all these things, this PR and journalism and pediatric healthcare really was important to me. And so when I graduated with my degree, my first job out of college was at a PR agency, which is an excellent place to kind of cut your teeth. And I traveled the country, had wonderful experiences, long hours, they burn ya. Was perfect for a single girl living in the city. I live in Chicago. And I worked on healthcare accounts. So I worked on hospital accounts and pharmaceuticals. And a lot of our pharmaceutical clients asked us to find a partner in the nonprofit world. So think about like one of my major accounts was a depression drug. And so we partnered with one of the suicide alliances. So that type of partnerships I really, really enjoyed. And so after I left there, I went to a hospital where was right next to my hometown in the suburbs of Chicago. And I worked in the PR team. And after about a year, they asked me to work part-time in their foundation. And so I had a dual role for almost 9 years as the media spokesperson for this community hospital and the event planner for the foundation. And during that time, we opened a brand new hospital. And so I was part of a capital campaign and some amazing experiences. But what I realized during that is that I didn't like the media part anymore. Much like Kristin, I think some of that is overwhelming. And being a 24/7 spokesperson for a hospital is a lot. I was having my babies and it was tough. And so I realized I really loved the fundraising world. And I was very, very fortunate to land a job in a corporate fundraising office. So I now work, I've been at Ace Hardware Corporation for 8.5 years. I never dreamed that my dream job would be in hardware. I am not a hardware gal, but I have probably been in hundreds and hundreds of Ace Hardwares across the country. So I now lead the Ace Foundation team, which last year our team raised about $18.9 million for our charitable partners. And so we do that through every which way, pennies at a time in our stores, through our vendor partners, and then in our corporate office. And it is the best job. And our charity of choice is Children's Miracle Network Hospitals. And one of those is the Children's Hospital in Iowa City. So really full circle. I work with the Dance Marathon crew now. And yeah, that's kind of my journey so far.
Thank you. That was very interesting. Love to see full circle. Hawkeye's back to help with Hawkeyes. Yeah. Michelle, can we hear from you a little bit more about your journey?
Yes, actually, I have very similar journey to the two of them as well. I originally did not start out in nonprofit. In fact, when I was in college, when I went to college right after high school, we didn't even have classes specific to nonprofits. Mm-hmm. And so my undergrad degree is actually in teaching and teaching English to speakers of other languages. And I actually had dreams of traveling the whole world. But when I got done with college, I actually did a short couple years stint at Lindell Mall in the marketing department. And then right shortly after that, I got bit by what we call the nonprofit bug. And I've dedicated my career to nonprofit ever since. I was at the Marion Chamber of Commerce for a while. And then I actually have had experience both with a national organization. I was with the American Cancer Society for many years. I kind of got into nonprofit in a sense because cancer has been close to my heart, because I've known many people in my life that have been touched by cancer, if you will. And so that's really where my passion for nonprofit started. then when my kids actually started college or were looking at colleges, I felt like, wow, something's kind of missing. I had been teaching part-time at Kirkwood in addition to working in nonprofit. And so I decided while I was working full-time at Mercy Medical Center in fundraising that I would go back and get my master's in philanthropy and nonprofit development. And so I did that as well as getting my CNP, Certified Nonprofit Professional from the National Leadership Alliance. And so, you know, it takes a really unique person that really wants to dedicate their career to nonprofit, but it's so incredibly rewarding. And I'm very, very thankful that I've made that decision. And now about a year and a half ago, I moved down here to Iowa City. And so I'm currently here at Community Crisis Services and Food Bank. And so that's also filling a niche that's been really important to me in my life. And that's helping people facing social determinants of health. And so here we help people in crisis, whether it's suicide prevention, crisis intervention, or through helping with basic needs or our food bank. And so it's very, very rewarding.
Thank you. I love the nonprofit bug analogy. I would say that is such a great analogy. I think most people can relate. If they want to go into nonprofit, you get a little bit and you just want more. But we appreciate all of you telling us about your nonprofit careers. And as students, we're learning about all the different roles that are within the nonprofit sector. So Chris, could you share some examples of roles that are filled by individuals at the ACE Hardware Foundation and what they are responsible for overseeing and implementing?
Sure. So I'm a little different because my foundation is within a corporation, right? So these corporate fundraising gigs are pretty tough to find. So if you find one, go for it. I think they're awesome because you are still a nonprofit. So we're our own 501c3. We're a private foundation. We're technically a subsidiary of ACE Hardware, but we've got corporate backing. So we can use all the resources that a global company that like ACE Hardware has, their legal team, their finance team, their marketing team. So we've got tremendous resources to talk about the charitable work that we do and help us do what we do. That being said, my little team, my little ACE Hardware Foundation team, we're a team of four and raising $18.9 million. And so I think anyone will find in nonprofits, we're typically pretty lean. You don't find a lot of like overstaffed nonprofits because that's not the goal. The goal is to raise as much money as possible. So you want to keep your expenses down, and the ACE Foundation is no different. We actually are not paid by ACE Hardware. We have to raise the funds for our salaries. We are self-funded. So as a separate foundation, we take our jobs really seriously. And so, like I said, there's four people on my team. And one of them is honestly, she's like a finance person. Like that is the heart of, I would say, many nonprofit offices, counting every penny, making sure that it gets to the right place, that everything balances. Like she is the heart of the team. She keeps us running. And that's really important. Database administrators are important. And so if you have experience with like a Razor's Edge or a Blackbaud or Salesforce, that's going to help you big time. So that's one person on my team. And then the other two, so one really oversees our volunteerism. And we have a pretty robust program at ACE. And she's looking to grow that into our stores and our warehouses. But she oversees that and then all of our corporate fundraising. So we kind of divide and conquer with different audiences. So her role is with all our employees across the globe. And then the other person, she really does all of our vendor fundraising. So think about if you walk through an ACE Hardware, who you'd see, like a Duracell, Milwaukee Tool, Stanley Black & Decker. Our vendors of it, like 18.9 million, they donated over 6 million of that. So they're a huge piece of our pie. And the way that they participate is we hold three huge golf outings, which sounds crazy, but they each raise over $1 million, and one's in Hawaii. And so Kelly on my team, she oversees all those events. So those experiences for not just our vendors, but they're the ones that really sponsor them and support them. But then our corporate team members can go to them and our store owners. So they're really great engagement events. And then my role as the director, I oversee the whole foundation. But the bucket that I take is our store owners. So we have over 5,000 stores, and every one of them has an affiliated Children's Miracle Network hospital that they can fundraise for. And when I started, there was about, of our, like at the time, there was probably, let's say 4,500 stores. When I started 8 years ago, only 800 of them were fundraising. They didn't really know much about it, even though we had been partners with CMN for over 20 some years. And my job was to get them on board. And as of last year, we had over close to 4,000 of our stores fundraising. So that's my job. It's my passion, is sharing the resources and tools that it takes to fundraise for our charitable partners. And so I oversee all of it, but that's my focus area.
Thank you. I can relate to that. I was the intern at UICA and then I moved to finance. So I understand the reconciliation because I do that every single month. So I completely understand how
it's important.
Yes. Thank you. Michelle, could you tell us more about fundraising and communication staff at Community and what their roles involve?
Sure, I'd be more than happy to. So, you know, one thing I do want to caution before I start into that is do keep in mind that the type of role that, or job or position that you're looking for in a nonprofit can really, really vary drastically based on the size and the scope of the nonprofit. So like for us in my areas, the areas that I oversee here at Community include marketing, communications, fundraising and development, volunteer coordination, and then advocacy. And so, you know, in some of the nonprofits that I've worked in previously, a lot of those were combined. Like when I was at the Marion Chamber of Commerce, I was responsible for both membership development as well as marketing. But here at Community, we actually work as a very close-knit team in regards to when we have big projects, we're all trying to work together on it because we don't have as much staff to be specifically focused and specialized in different areas, except for fundraising. We do have a grants and data analyst, and that person is in charge of all aspects of our grants, from grants research to the actual process of applying for the grant, overseeing the team that's in charge of that, as well as compliance if we get the award, and then handles a lot of our data in regards to our program data, and keeping track of the services and kind of the impact that our services are having in the community. Underneath fundraising, we actually have staff that specialize very specifically into special events fundraising. And then we have staff that are moving more into major gifts and planned giving. And we have some support staff too that help with the donation processing. And we've got a constituent relations coordinator that actually really oversees and manages our database and takes care of all of our acknowledgments and our receipting and our matching gifts and some of those pieces. Then underneath our marketing and communications, we have a coordinator that focuses very specifically just on the design aspect of things. So designing any of our print ads, designing any of our materials, brochures, those types of things, all the way up to our banners. And we just opened up a new location and she designed the window wraps for the whole front of the new food bank that we just opened a few months ago. From there, we also have a communications person, a marketing communications person who focuses very specifically on the media and our media relations. We have a very challenging media market here in Johnson County, and she focuses very specifically on working directly with the media and trying to get our name out there, making sure that she's working with the local radio and TV stations, as well as the newspapers, to get information out there, make sure people know that our services are available and what we're doing. And then we also have someone who focuses very specifically on social media And I will tell you that person is oversees everything that we have with our website. And I'll tell you that this last year, with the changes we've had to make with COVID, I have been extremely surprised, very, very thankful and grateful that we've seen a significant increase in the traffic to our website and donations coming in through crowdsourcing and peer-to-peer fundraising. It's been amazing. So that person kind of works on all of those components for us. And then we do rely pretty heavily on interns, and we're very thankful that we've been able to partner with Jen and with different departments at the University of Iowa to help us with some of our other projects when it comes to some of our specific campaigns and some of our outreach events.
I know the students really appreciate all the internship opportunities and real world experience we can get as much as you appreciate us. It's definitely a two-way street. So thank you for letting us have those opportunities and for telling us more about the staff at Community.
Thank you.
Yeah. Kristin, because of United Way's vision to create positive community change, we know that the bulk of your staff fall within the departments of marketing and communications, resource development, community impact, and volunteer engagement. Can you give students a sense of the overall activities and goals that these teams focus on?
Sure. And one thing, I was pulling it up as Michelle was talking, she said, you know, it looks different in a whole bunch of things. And Chris mentioned it's very lean in nonprofits. And I don't know if you know of Simon Sinek, but yesterday his daily email said lack of time plus lack of resources plus optimism equals innovation. And I was like, that is nonprofit in a nutshell, lack of time, lack of resources, but you got to figure it out. And you somehow are able with that optimism, be able to get it. So I just wanted to add that in. We do, we have a staff of 21. So with United Way, we raise anywhere from over the last couple of years, if I'm honest and transparent, we've been going downhill in fundraising. So this year we will raise about $6 million. Over the last 2 years, we've lost about $1 million each year. So we were at about 8 million 2 to 3 years ago. Along those lines, as we said, with like, you know, the leanness, we have also had to lean out our staff. So in marketing, we have three people. We have the person who leads the department, who does a lot of strategy and also gets their hands into implementation. And then we have a content writer and we have a graphic designer, and they are really looking at that whole picture, right? Of what is it that we are needing to get out there for fundraising? What is it that we need to get out there in terms of our mission and our values and our vision and what the impact we are making in the community? And so our little mighty marketing team is only about three people. Resource development is about the bulk of the biggest departments. There are, I'm thinking, five people within that department, in which we have obviously the VP of resource development. She focuses a lot, along with myself, having our own portfolios of major donors, planned giving, being able to work in those realms. And then we also have just hired a new major gifts officer. We transitioned a little bit. United Way, if any of you know of us, we are really steeped in the tradition of doing what we call workplace campaigns. So that's where when you go into your work, when you work somewhere, you may actually encounter this. And someone will say, hey, it is the next 2 weeks, we are having our United Way campaign. And we are going to just do some fun things. We're going to have some games. If everyone participates, there'll be a drawing for new days off and extra time off. And there's just a whole bunch of energy wrapped around that. And what we're finding is that workplace campaign is going down because people don't work at the same place for 30 years like they used to. And there's also no longer that peer hierarchical pressure of, well, my boss told me to donate, so I guess I better donate. So United Ways along the way, it's a fascinating whole nother conversation. We're really reinventing ourselves right now. Because of that, we actually have changed a little bit when it comes to having someone focused just on what we call the corporate campaign. And we're really starting to look towards more of those major donors as well. And then we have about three other staff members who are focused on that corporate campaign, because in the end, the workplace campaigns, it does raise us nearly $6 million a year, right? So there's quite a bit of dollars that are coming in. And for our size of market in Cedar Rapids, we actually outraise what our peer groups of certain population sizes do across the country consistently over and over again. So I do think that's something when we think about the nonprofit sector in East Central Iowa, about our 5-county corridor area, we have a very rich nonprofit group and sector that is amazing. We also have a community impact department that's split up a little bit, but they're really coming together and working well. We have volunteers, so we have 3 staff within working within volunteers. And we found that this is a place for United Way, for us specifically, to really shine within our area and being able to help train volunteers, being able to be the people who are in charge of volunteers when a disaster strikes, which came in really handy with that derecho that we had back in August, and just being able to really make those connections. It also allows us, when you're thinking about Chris, right, and that corporate social responsibility that corporations have, they're not everyone is as focused as what Ace Hardware is. They've got their partner with CMN, but you may have all of these other corporations that are like, well, we really care about veterans and we care about homelessness too. And so we've noticed with our volunteer group, we can really focus on two different sections, individual volunteers, along with the corporate volunteer section as well. And then the other piece of community impact focuses on how we invest the dollars we raise into the community and what those overarching goals are. A lot of times within nonprofits, like Michelle and her nonprofit, they're very focused on food, right? United Way is looking at that bigger top 30,000 level foot picture. It's that idea of homelessness isn't just happening in a vacuum. There is also maybe substance abuse. There's financial stability that happens with it. There may be mental health that goes along with it. We're looking at that overarching goal. And so from our community impact side, the other piece, they're really looking at what those goals are that we are looking at for our community, along with then how we are investing our dollars to get us as a whole, as a community, to achieving those goals. And then the most important department, which Chris referenced, is finance and admin. We have, right, CFO, accountant, accounts receivable, accounts payable, and we have a technology, she could go anywhere, technology guru / database guru. And I would agree with the comment of if you have Razor's Edge or database experience, you will be appreciated very greatly, because the databases are really the key as to driving your donor engagement, knowing who to look for, doing all of the research. So we focus on those 4 areas for our departments, but it is a collaborative effort when it comes to the team. And I think that, I don't know if Michelle and Chris would agree, that's the fun part, is you have these different focuses, but yet in a nonprofit, you can't just say, this is my job. You have to always be looking out, and you see immediately how all the connections come together. And I don't know if you guys would have comments about this, but it's always interesting when someone comes from for-profit to a nonprofit. It's almost as if they're just used to kind of going down their lane, right? And then all of a sudden it's like, oh no, you can totally be in charge of that. You don't even need to ask for permission. If you want to change the form, just change the form. But there's just a different culture when it comes to the nonprofits versus corporate.
Thank you. All of you have described so many positions, and it's so nice to hear about real world jobs and the different opportunities, because you hear about these broad categories like, okay, yeah, marketing. But within marketing and communication, there's a bunch of branches underneath. So it's really awesome for us as students to see those real world careers and what the corporations and companies around us are actually implementing and what the positions are that they have. So we have one more panel question, and then we will break into Q&A. So our final question is that, so first, we are learning a lot of technical skills in school, like writing an effective solicitation letter, developing a budget, utilizing a donor database, which a lot of you have touched on. Can you help us understand what you have found invaluable when it comes to soft skills, those skills that relate to the emotional intelligence and natural ability to work, interact with well with others? Okay, obviously these soft skills need some work. Okay, Michelle, which soft skills do you suggest we strengthen as we prepare to enter a nonprofit career? Can you give some examples of a couple of examples of staff members who demonstrate really effective soft skills.
Yeah, you know, I was trying to give this question some thought because I agree with both of the other two panelists, Chris and Kristin, that there's a huge difference between for-profit and nonprofit. And the more I was thinking about this, I have a little sign that I have made and I've taken in every office that I've ever had in every nonprofit I've worked at. And it's, blessed are the flexible, for they shall not be bent out of shape. And to me, I think flexibility is huge. It is huge. And, you know, depending on the size of the nonprofit that you go to, whether you're able to really specialize and hone your skills in one area or not, you still need to be flexible. And just like the other two panelists have said, you have to wear so many different hats. You have to be flexible. And, you know, things don't always turn out the way that you plan for them to. And like the derecho was a huge example. And COVID was another big example. You know, it's not many people that can say that in their lifetime they lived through a year where there was not only a statewide natural disaster, but national economic crisis and a worldwide pandemic. You have to be flexible and you have to be able to immediately respond to the needs, not only the needs of the people that you serve and that, but, you know, the needs to the community overall. As far as examples and some of the other soft skills, one of them that I really was, that keeps ringing true for me is, I don't know if empathy is really the right word that I want to use, but that compassion. And so some of the staff that I work with here at Community, some of them that I really feel excel in their role the most and really exemplify what it's like to be part of a nonprofit are those that are able to understand the needs of our clients, understands the needs of our of the people that we are here to help, and do it in a very non-judgmental, but also very compassionate way. And most of all, treating them with dignity. And so it's really challenging sometimes when you're dealing with things like we do deal with food insecurity, but we also do suicide prevention and we also do crisis intervention. So, you know, it's really, really some pretty heavy stuff that you deal with. And so I think the skills that I look for the most, or I think that are the most helpful, are being flexible and then kind of having that compassion. Most of the time when people choose a career in nonprofit, they're choosing purpose over paycheck, because I'll be completely honest with you, most of us could make more money working for a for-profit organization, but also knowing that, you know, we really believe in and have a passion for the mission of what we're working for. So the staff that I think have been most successful and have that are the ones that really are able to relate to and understand what our clients are facing and what they're going through and their needs and how we can help them. And then being able to turn around and tell that story and being able to do that in a very professional manner to, you know, tell a donor, you know, here's how your support can help. Here's an example of, you know, someone we've been able to help because of your support, or being able to communicate the importance of those services. So flexibility and compassion / empathy would be the two biggest ones that I can think of.
Thank you. That is always so helpful to hear about what real world skills you should be focusing on, because you learn, okay, I need this test, I need to learn this, 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 but focusing on those skills that aren't always built in the classroom and are built in-person interactions, or right now, Zoom interactions.
Yeah, and you know, actually, depending on the size of the nonprofit, I said, you know, you might wear many hats, but you know, like in our office, I get up and answer the door just like everybody else. You know, the buzzer rings and somebody's at the door and needs something, and it might be from us or one of our partner nonprofits that are located in one of our buildings. And, you know, so being able to have that ability to be flexible, work in many different areas, but also be able to relate back to the clients that we serve.
Yeah. Well, thank you for letting us know what you've thought and learned from your experiences.
You're welcome.
Kristin, what insights do you have for us on the topic of soft skills?
Yeah, I think, Michelle, you just hit some really good ones. A few that I think about, United Way is very known for its collaboration and the convening that it does. And I think collaboration is one of just those soft skills that can be really hard. It's easier to say, and you've all worked in group projects and you know this, it's easier just for me to do it myself than to wait for that person to get their stuff done, right? And I think of a project that we're working on right now in which we're collaborating with the city of Cedar Rapids and the Linn County. And we were ready to go in the beginning of February, and we're still waiting, and we're really hoping that project is going to take off in the next 2 weeks. But we also know, because of the collaboration, we're building relationships, we're building trust, we're going to have a better end product because of, instead of us doing three separate projects, we're doing one, and we'll get a better turnout with it. And so I think being able to have that collaboration and that mindset is something that's really important. It's hard though, because like I said, it is easier just to do it yourself. However, once you have that trust within the community and people know that you have their back, they're going to be there for you as well. And so it's just one of those pieces where it's always for those type A's who just want to get it done, or if you're an achiever through Strengths Finders and you just want to check it off the list, it can be hard. Pot calling kettle black right there, but it is something that is really, really fabulous to be able to have. I also look back over just the derecho this past year, kind of that, like Michelle was talking about, that dual disaster. We had COVID, plus we had the derecho last year. And I would honestly say a nonprofit, and it kind of goes with Michelle's point, it's resiliency. You see a lot in nonprofit work. I remember the days at Ronald McDonald House, to Chris's point, when you see those kids who are cancer patients and you see them walk by, and it is a 2x4 because you have a pity party for yourself that day and you think, I'm good. I am fine in life. Or in my time at Four Oaks, you see children as young as 5 who need to be removed from the homes and have mental and behavioral therapy because of the life that they've had from 0 to 5. It gets really hard. And even with the derecho, from a managerial standpoint, you could see the people who had resiliency and the people who didn't. And they were the ones who were able to show up. They were able to take care of themselves and yet also be able to give of themselves. And they were also able to say, hold up, I need about 3 hours and I'll be back and I can do this, versus the ones who just kind of sat back and were just very quiet and you weren't even sure if they were going to be able to make it that day. And so I think that resiliency and grit, and you're only going to get that by going through tough situations, right? The tougher the situation you go through, the more you're going to be able to be like, I can do that. And to your point, Isabel, about running a marathon for Dance Marathon, I will say, I firmly believe anyone can physically run a marathon and finish it. It's whether or not mentally you can or not, is what it comes down to. And being just even having an experience like that gives you that grit and that resiliency that you know you can draw deep within yourself to go through. And then the last one, I know this one's going to make me sound old, and I'm not trying to call anybody out on this one, but when it comes to Zoom and fundraising and nonprofits, it's all about relationships. And turn your camera on, people. I want to see your faces. I want to know who I'm talking to. I want to see if you're engaged. I want to know if you're enjoying it or not. And that's just, I honestly think, as soft skills as the generation coming up, you guys, I am not a technology native, right? I am a face-to-face native. That is how I grew up. And as we continue to move forward, being able to have those skill sets to be able to relate to people face-to-face is going to become less and less. And if you have that, it is amazing how far you see that go when you meet with a donor and when you have that ability to connect with someone.
Thank you so much. I love to hear from all of you because you offer such great advice. I am over looking at my other monitor taking notes as everyone's talking. So if you see that, I'm taking notes. But thank you so much for your advice. Chris, we'd love to hear your thoughts regarding soft skills.
Yeah, it's funny. I wrote down a few words in preparation, and Michelle and Kristin have said them. So I think we're all on the same page. I wrote relationships. I wrote adaptability, I wrote schlepping, which I'll get to. And I think a big one for us at ACE, our CEO uses the term servant heart. And it's something that I live by, and I love that he uses that he leads with a servant heart, and he expects that we all do the same. And especially in the foundation, I think that, like Michelle said, when you have a team who truly believes in the mission of whatever nonprofit you support, or multiple nonprofits, but when you can really understand your mission. So for us, we get to meet a lot of the kids and families, and that is so rewarding and extremely hard. We've lost a lot of kiddos. I've been at funerals. I've been asked to speak at funerals. I've gotten so close with some of these kids. I had a little boy text me before his MRI 2 days ago, telling me how brave he was being. I've been invited to the ceremony where they ring a bell when they're done with the chemo. Like, this little boy invited the Ace Hardware team. And that's because our team is all in. And we don't just, I mean, we practice what we preach. And so when we're asking people to make a donation, it's a genuine ask, and we believe it. And I think you can see that. And you know, for me, I try and tell my cashiers across the country in ACE stores, I try and educate them about why we ask them to ask at the register. Because if you ever gone to a store and they say, would you like to make a donation? And they say it so fast, and you're like, I'm sorry, what was that? And they're like, I don't even know. Like, they just tell me to ask this, and wow, that really makes me want to donate. And so I think we really try and share that mission. And so I think that servant heart and that part of being like a purpose-driven culture is a tremendous kind of skill to have. And I'll talk about schlepping. And no one tells you this, and it doesn't matter, like Michelle said, she answers the door. It doesn't matter your title. You have to be able to put titles aside at any given point. I was literally schlepping patio furniture yesterday in our warehouse, and our president does too. In the nonprofit world, there's a lot of schlepping, and that, like, there's always something in my trunk that's like, my kids are like, Mom, what is this sign? What is this prize? What is this raffle basket? Can I play with that? And there's always something, and it doesn't matter your title. You have to get your hands dirty and be willing, and there can't be any hesitation. I will tell you that any member of my team at any point would, if a table falls, we're all running to get it up. It doesn't matter. And it could be from our president down to our intern. So I think the willingness to jump in wherever you're needed, which may be way above your head or what you may think is way below. I think that I learned early on, like, some things in the beginning, I'm like, I can't believe you're trusting me with this. And in my career, I really don't think about anymore that things are below me, because they're not. It's all part of our mission and that servant heart and that purpose-driven culture. It doesn't matter how small or large the task. So I think that's really important. And then just lastly, like Kristin said, the relationship building. Fundraising is literally relationship building. And I have traveled the country to, like I said, hundreds of Ace Hardware stores, just building relationships. And I'm not saying people start fundraise or donate because of me, but it's sharing the how, the why, the tools to do it, and building that trust and that relationship. These days, consumers, everyone is asked for donations constantly. So how do you choose? How do you connect and figure out which one is meaningful to that person and show them why? And I think, you know, I say half my job is like a therapist. Like, when I store owners, sometimes I get them on the phone and I'm just a different voice. I'm still related to the business. I always say fundraising is good for business, but I'm kind of different. So they want to tell me all their problems. And then at the end, they're like, oh yeah. And then we're having an event for CMN. I mean, there's just, because we've built that relationship. And so I think that's always important. So turn on your cameras, write a handwritten note. I love a handwritten note. It's like my favorite thing. Our CEO leaves handwritten notes on people's desks all over the company. I've kept every one of them. And they don't say a lot, but they mean a lot. So when you're interviewing, write a handwritten note. I'll tell you, it sets you apart. Anyone can write an email. So I think some of those, I know we sound old, Kristin, but some of those are tried and true. And I think it's a bit of a lost art, but We like faces, we like handwritten notes.
This has been such great advice. I think I can speak for everyone here. It is great to hear the things that can set you apart, to show the passion that you all have for your organizations and really what it means to be passionate about your organization and do a good job for what you believe in. Because being in nonprofits, I think that's something that sets everyone apart is, okay, I really do believe in this and I go to work every day for something that I believe in, which is why I really want to go in nonprofits, but that's a whole nother story. So let's get into the Q&A session because I have gotten a few questions and I have written a lot of questions, but I can always send those to you if other people have questions. But if you have a question and don't want to ask it, I can ask it. You can send it to me via a private message in the chat. You can raise your hand and unmute yourself and ask the question. Anything works. Erin, I know you have a question. Would you want to unmute yourself and ask?
Yeah, absolutely. I can kick it off. Always love to be the first voice to pipe up at the with the question. But I really enjoyed listening to all the panelists. And I think a common theme throughout all of your past has kind of been moving from a corporate job to a more nonprofit-based job. So that was really interesting, kind of an experience that I haven't gotten to see. We talked a little bit about the culture with that. I was kind of also wondering about the kind of like Midwest culture with Iowa in particular. And I know with ACE, which is definitely the place with the helpful hardware folks, they kind of have a culture of giving and support and kind of that Iowa nice stance. I was wondering how that culture kind of impacts how you operate in a nonprofit. And if you've had any nonprofit or corporate experience outside of that kind of Iowa nice or Midwest culture, and if it kind of changed how you operated or if you learned anything from that.
I don't know if it's necessarily like the corporate versus nonprofit, but I think back to my days when I was a development officer for Coe College, and just how when you interact with people, they deal with fundraisers on a different ways, right? So you may have the person who is all about just chit-chatting and you've got an hour and you know you get like 2 minutes to slip in what you want, right? And then that's all you get. And you've got to listen about their kids and their grandkids and their whatever else is going on. You have the person who is going to be upfront and they are talking business those first 5, 10, 15 minutes. They get it done. And then you're talking about their kids and their grandkids and anything else that happens. And then there are the people who have never been involved in a fundraiser before and they are nervous as all get out and they just never want to talk about it. So I don't know if it's from like the corporate to the nonprofit, but I think from like the overall fundraising aspect, and it gets to a little bit of the relationship building and the people skills, the soft skills. You have to be able to read people. You have to be able to read who you're with, who you're experiencing and how they want to be, how they want to work together.
Yeah, I'd say for us, what I've seen, so I recently, about 2 years ago, was asked to take a dual role at ACE, which I haven't talked about that other half, but I also oversee employee engagement. And that is not my area of expertise. I don't come from an HR background. Like I said, I come from journalism and PR and event planning and fundraising. And our president said to me, I think this is a great opportunity for you because I've seen what you've done in the foundation and how you've grown our fundraising from like $3 million to $18 million. He's like, I want you to take that magic and like spread it here at corporate. And really it all comes down to meaningfulness. So every business has some kind of purpose, whatever that is. The problem is sometimes employees, so that culture that you're creating, all the employees need to know what their purpose is. If they don't, you find an unengaged employee. And that's, sadly, they say like over half of US employees are unengaged. And that's really dangerous and expensive. And so what I've learned in my 2 years of being overseeing employee engagement for a global corporation, I've learned a lot. And I think we are so successful because we have this purpose-driven kind of meaningfulness in our culture. That's just who we are. We exist to help others. That's our mantra. Like you said, we're the helpful hardware folks. I thought you might sing it, but we exist to help others, whatever that means. So if we're helping our store owners who are helping their communities and their customers, they're the local hardware, we all know what our purpose is. And our CEO makes it very clear that we all have purpose in our roles. And I think if you work somewhere that doesn't take the time to really, explain that to their employees or make sure that they feel that meaningfulness, and then you add on a layer of like having our foundation and giving back in such a big way and feeling that pride, that creates your culture. And I'm blessed. I was handed a beautiful culture. It was nothing I had to fix. I just had to continue to grow it. And I think it's because we had a really good foundation of knowing that meaningfulness and that purpose.
I didn't really have anything additional to add that, you know, Kristin and Chris haven't already mentioned. I completely agree. I think that that passion has to be there. You know, you just, and that's the thing that I think makes it really hard, especially when you go through traumatic times like what we've experienced within the last year, is making sure that you're doing everything you can to keep inspiring not only your fellow employees and the people that you work with, but your volunteers also, and finding ways to keep motivating them. And honestly, being there during the tough times. I mean, you know, I agree with both Chris and Kristin, you know, you've got to get your hands dirty. You've got to schlep it, if you will. You know, there's so much to be done, but you have to be there for each other as well, because killing that passion that's detrimental. That's detrimental not only to the person themselves, but to your overall organization. So that's the only thing. I agree with everything that they've just said.
Thank you all. So our next question is from Cassandra Beatrice. If you want to unmute yourself and ask.
All right. Hello, everyone. As you can tell, I'm not from America. So I have a lot of questions for you, but I'll stick it to two questions. First question is, how is your veterans base in terms of clientele and or workers or volunteers? My second question is that I'm a veteran myself. I'm disabled also, and I also experienced homelessness within active duty. With that being said, the reason why I'm saying this is because I have a for-profit that will feed into a non-profit idea that I've been thinking about for the past, I don't know, I'd say at most 15 years. I used to teach kids in England with disabilities. And of course it's that rewarding sense, you know what I mean? But then when I went into the military, I kind of evolved my nonprofit idea to veterans specifically. Do you think that a for-profit feeding a nonprofit is successful? So those are I promise, only gonna be two questions.
Well, I can start out really quickly. Interestingly, when I got my master's in philanthropy and nonprofit development, one of the things that I was looking at was social enterprise and the impact of unearned income strategies on nonprofits. And so I first want to start out by saying thank you. Thank you so much for your service. Greatly, greatly appreciate that. There's a lot of different models out there as far as hybrids, and there's been a lot of transition and change in the kind of a melding, if you will, between for-profit and nonprofit. And I think, you know, Chris's role is a perfect example of how a for-profit can, I don't want to say feed, but can play a huge, significant role in giving back to the community by having a nonprofit arm. So I admire any for-profit company that is willing to do that and willing to make that kind of an investment into helping the communities that they serve. You asked specifically about veterans, and I'm actually ashamed to tell you that I don't have an answer for where I'm at. I know that in a lot of the communities where I have worked, that unfortunately suicide rates among veterans are quite high compared to other areas, and there is a large problem with homelessness among veterans. We do welcome veterans as far as receiving our services, but also I know we have quite a few veterans that volunteer with us. I unfortunately am not able to give you a percentage on that. But I think that the veterans themselves have so much to offer that we would welcome any type of involvement that a veteran would want to provide to our organization.
Yeah, I'll echo. Thank you for your service. I think ACE is, we have a kind of a special relationship with veterans. We have a separate program for any veterans that want to actually open an ACE store. We have like a, it's its own channel because we do have quite a few veterans, and you know, a lot of our stores give veteran discounts, and we actually employ a lot of veterans. Some of my favorite store employees are older veterans who they're retired, but they love the hardware stores and they just want to help people. And so we do have a whole program from a foundation perspective. So we have two main charitable partners. So CMN is one. Our other national charity partner is the Red Cross. And in Chicago here, our Red Cross actually runs a food pantry at our Veterans Hospital. And so we, during non-COVID times, the ACE team would go and we help run that. I'd say, I think it's twice a month. And it's for veterans only. And that's one of our most, I'd say, beloved volunteer projects. There's a waiting list for it. And it's something that we are very proud of. And then, like Michelle said, I mean, I guess I'm a perfect example of, I do believe that we're going to see more and more as the CSR world grows. There's a lot more corporate foundations these days. And I think also, as Kristin noted, corporations are kind of honing in on charitable partners, whereas before we were founded 30 years ago, before that, we were given to like hundreds of different charities because we get letters every day and requests. And so our board decided, instead of making very little impact by giving to many, let's pick one or two and make a big impact. And I believe that's where it's going, is that companies are taking a stand on like something they feel strongly about, and then really focusing on a charitable partner, whether they establish a foundation or not. So I think it absolutely is a beautiful thing when it's done right.
The only thing I would add is United Way focuses usually on three buckets: financial stability, health, and education, because we know those are the three pillars that people need to have to be successful. And so our organization does not personally focus just on veterans. I do know of organizations that we do fund, they do have veterans programming. So for instance, the homeless shelter, Will Estate here in Cedar Rapids has a veterans program. HACAP has a veterans program as well, our community action program here in East Central Iowa. So there are, and gosh, there's Honor Flight. There's a bunch that are focused around veterans. So I don't think that just because United Way doesn't solely focus on a veterans program, we're focusing for all. There is a passion for it for sure. And same thing, my time at Ronald McDonald House was amazing. I mean, McDonald's started the Ronald McDonald House, the first one in Philadelphia. That's what it came down to. And even to this day, McDonald's corporate pays for Ronald McDonald House global employees' salaries. So Ronald McDonald House Global can say they have a 0% admin fee. Now there's a whole bunch of other complications that come with that, right? But it, most definitely there is that corporate piece that's gonna fall into it.
Yeah, and I just wanted to add for both Michelle and you, Kristin, that please don't ever feel ashamed if you don't know the statistics or anything. I'm sure the services you guys provide in terms of nonprofit to any veterans is amazing. Because I know that we all need it, others more than me, because I'm physically able. But my idea is I want to either hire specific artists or I teach them myself for like a long period of time. And then I build final pieces that are like good enough to sell. And then my for-profit will be the exhibition of their work. and hopefully like this, my business is technically a transition out of the military because there is not really a huge transition program. You're trained for at least a year or 2 years when you enter the military, right? But you literally have a week of classes on how to build a resume and how to live in the real world after your military service. I'm not even kidding you. And so that is such a short period of time if you've been in the military for like 30 years, you know? So my business and my chosen venue, so to speak, I want it to be like a transitional period where it's not necessarily a permanent home, but you know, veterans can be sheltered out, whatever. And then my exhibition side will be their work and their resumes or their business cards or whatever. And then if they choose to come back to teach other veterans, that's my business goal. And I have no idea if it'll be successful because of all the bureaucracy with the VA. I really don't want to go down to the VA route, but we'll see. And I just really appreciate that there actually is a nonprofit in Cedar Rapids. His name is Scott Dressler. He's a fantastic person. I don't know if anybody knows him, but his business is called the Community of Artists and Veterans, and his business is in the Veterans Memorial Building in Cedar Rapids. So you guys should really check him out. He serves veterans and their kids and spouses and stuff. And it's just, he's just great. And he's just been my go-to person. He's really inspiring. So I just really appreciate your guys' time. So thank you.
We do have a couple more questions, but I first want to thank everyone for coming. And I understand we are a little past time. So if you have to go, thank you for coming. Thank you for all the students for attending. And AFPCC is sponsored by the Certificate in Nonprofit Leadership and Philanthropy. And you'll receive an email tomorrow with a link of the recording to this event and to the websites of AFPCC and the Nonprofit Leadership Certificate. If you're not already a member of AFPCC, feel free to join. We would love to have you. Check out our website and you can submit a membership form for an access to all of the great resources offered through AFPCC. But if you do want to stick around for the last two questions, feel free. But if you have somewhere to be, go ahead. Thank you for joining us and have a great night. But our last question, so we have one for Michelle about your CNP, and do you feel if it was helpful for you to pursue that certification?
Yeah, actually, that's a very good question because, like I mentioned, when I first got started in nonprofit, there weren't any classes about it. And actually, it was very easy for me. I've been in nonprofit for over 25 years, almost 30 years now. And so it was very easy for me to get the CNP because it's based in different, there's different categories, and then they measure how much time and the different projects and your role in those projects and what you've done to prove that you've got the competencies in those areas. So there's a level that is through the academic where you can put in different coursework and the objectives that were met with that coursework. And then there's also a section for actual field experience, actual work that you've done. And so, yeah, it's been helpful for me. I didn't get it until just a few years ago. So I had already, you know, spent quite a few years in the nonprofit sector, but it was nice to know that at least I have that to recognize the experience that I have. So.
Okay, thank you. And our final question is everyone about what is something that you wish you knew before you started working in the nonprofit sector?
Okay, I'm sorry. I started laughing as soon as you asked that, and I apologize. I shouldn't have reacted that way. I don't know how to say this in a nice way. I really wish I would have known before I got started in nonprofit just how to prevent burnout. I mean, you know, it's just there's so many parts of the work that are mentally and emotionally taxing. I know Chris and Kristin both talked about, you know, seeing the people that they've helped and, you know, like going to the oncology floor and seeing the patients and stuff. I had no idea. I knew, you know, I was kind of joking a little bit about, you know, being kind of bit by the nonprofit bug. But one of the things that I think I wish that would have done me, that would have helped me an awful lot along the way, was just more of that understanding that it is very, very emotionally taxing, and, you know, having that support system for yourself, having those ways of being able to kind of release that. And, you know, sometimes you go home at night and you just cry yourself to sleep for a while because you weren't able to help somebody a specific way. So for me, I think I wish I would have known better ways to help not only myself, but my staff and my volunteers that I work with, how to kind of prevent burnout, because it can be very overwhelming and very, it can be very overwhelming at times.
Kind of along those same lines, a lot of people who go into nonprofit have a big heart, and there's a lot of emotions in the office. And that's something for someone who's not a super emotional person, that can sometimes be difficult, because you've got people who have these big emotions and they want, right? They want to express them, they want to feel them, and that's how they process, where that's not necessarily how I process. And that's something I've had to learn along the way. And I think the one thing too, for me, not being trained as a social worker, I wasn't informed around like trauma-informed care, ACEs, all of that work. If you're going to go into nonprofits, it would be important for you to just get a little couple classes, some education training around, like I said, trauma-informed care and adverse childhood experiences and how those play into the work that nonprofits do.
My answer was going to be the same as Michelle's, except I'm going to kind of reverse it and say, I wish I knew how great it was going to be. I wish someone could have told me, because I think coming out of college, I was a little bit about the money and all the flash and, you know, and I did that. I worked, like I said, in an agency where I got those experiences. I got to travel and stay in Manhattan and, you know, I really am glad I did it, but it wasn't who I was. And I knew what I wanted to do. I think I just had to find the way to get there. And I wish I would have known that if someone could have told me, like, you're going to end up with your dream job at Ace Hardware. And in the nonprofit world, man, I think, not that I regret any of my journey, because I think it all brought me to where I need to be. But it's better than I think I could have imagined. And I'm not saying it's easy, but it's extraordinarily rewarding. And Isabel, just like you said, I think there are those of us who, if I said to myself, especially when I started having kids, if I'm gonna leave my kids every day, it better be for a good reason. And that's just my, for me. And so I feel very blessed that I was able to find a job that every day, not that I'm, well, some days I'd love to leave my kids, but, I know that I'm making a difference, and that was very important to me. That's what drives me. It doesn't drive everyone, but if you know that's in your heart, you'll find it. I think you have to stay true to it.
Well, Isabel messaged me and said that it was okay if I just jump in and ask one final question. So we have, obviously, coming up very quickly, a lot of seniors who will be going out into the working world, and they've been working hard at finding jobs and what that next step will be. Just wanted to get your feedback regarding what you can share in the way of, you know, looking at these, you know, jobs that are available. I'm quick to encourage students to go ahead and apply for the jobs that say 1 to 3 years experience and everything. I just wanted to, you know, see if you agree with that, if you feel like, you know, because they're all like, well, I have to have my first job and I have to gain experience. And so it's this catch 22. And so is there anything you would say on, you know, that real practical side of applying for jobs that even might give students pause to think, oh, they would never hire me, you know, kind of thing?
Yeah, I'd say go for it. You just don't know what the applicant pool is. We are hiring for a director of marketing and communications right now, and we had a great pool for it. I mean, top level experience that I am shocked the amount of experience we have. So I was floored. On the flip side, we have an accountant position that's been open for 3 weeks now, and we've had 3 applications. the job market is just so, so tight, go for it. And I do, something I have always said is not everybody wants to be a fundraiser. If you are okay asking people for money, you have a special skill set that will ensure you have a job the rest of your life, because we're a rare breed, right? And so you just don't know what you would be able to fall into. And like Chris said, I mean, you can fall into something that you just absolutely love that you had no idea that you're gonna love it. Take the risk, why not? The worst they can say is no. And you've heard that in your classes, make the ask. The worst they'll say is no, it's not personal.
I agree. And I think the more interview experience you can get, the better. And so if nothing else, think of it as practice and learn. You know, practice answering those questions, practice telling stories. You know, I just did a bunch of interviews for, we have an intern every year, and some of those, you know, I think it was a little bit of, there was fear and nervousness, which is totally fair, but I'll tell you what set our candidate that we chose apart was her ability to relate to the position. And I'll tell you one, what sold me on her was she told me that she was very upfront and said, I don't shop at Ace Hardware a lot. Now, most college kids don't. I didn't either. But she said, but I wanted to be prepared. It was so cute. I wanted to be prepared for this interview because I didn't know if you'd ask me questions about tools. And I was like, oh, sweet Jesus. And so she said, last night I was driving home and I passed an Ace Hardware and I made a U-turn and I went in. And I spent over a half hour walking the aisles and talking to the associates. And I told them I had this interview. And she said, they were rooting for me. They were so lovely. And oh my gosh, if this is what Ace Hardware is about. And wow, I mean, talk about going. So figure out what's going to set you apart. I'm going to tell that story for my whole career. Because what a brilliant thing to do. The fact that she took the time to walk the aisles to learn about tools for a fundraising internship is just amazing. So it's, what is that extra thing that you can talk about in that interview? And I think the more you do it, you'll figure it out. But I think specific stories are really important that may erase that 1 to 3 years experience. So I love that. So that's just my little story that I was pretty impressed.
I want to agree with both Kristin and Chris, because for me, we actually just redid our pay structure to include internships and volunteer positions as experience. So we have a whole pay scale based on the number of years of experience and so forth. And we just redid it to include that portion as well. But I agree, something that sets you apart, I mean, if it's a job that you really think that you would enjoy doing and you would want to do, by all means, go for it. I mean, it could be that it ends up being, you know, more experience for you in interviewing, but find something that sets you apart. And I think speaking from your heart is the big piece of that. If it's an area and something that you really are interested in and really, really think that it would help, you could see your soul really singing in that position, tell them that, speak from the heart. Because a lot of times when we're on the other side and we're writing the job descriptions and, you know, one of us referred to it earlier in the thing about, you know, some budget cuts and possibly reducing some staff. When we're sitting there and then we have those hard decisions, we're like, okay, well, maybe we need to combine this position and combine this position. And maybe we can add this here and that there. And we're writing those job descriptions. You know, we're looking for specific things, yes. But the biggest thing we're really, really looking for is passion and somebody who really wants to be a part of that team. I love that story that somebody did a U-turn and spent time talking to the associates in the store and walking the store and feeling the culture. We want someone who's going to fit in that culture. You know, if you've got the skills and experience, great. But you know what? A lot of that can be taught. But the personality and fitting in and being a good fit and believing in the mission and having passion for the work that we do, that's stuff that can't be taught. And that's what you really need to make sure that sets you apart. So I agree with both Chris and Kristin. Go ahead, apply, throw your hat in the ring and be you and tell them how you feel like you'd be a good fit for that organization.
Thank you all for all the advice and the questions offered. I am still trying to figure out what I want to do after college. So this is very good, very good for me to be here. I mean, I'm moderating, so I had to be here, but it's great to be here and hearing everything that everyone has to say. Thank you for staying late and answering all our questions. I know it's very appreciated by everyone, and I hope that everyone has a good night and can enjoy the sunshine. At least here, it's finally sunny for the first time in a long time.
The last thing, if I can add, I'm going to drop my contact information in, just my email. And if anybody has any questions or wants any type to reach out or connect in any way, please just let me know. I'm happy to do so.
Yeah, and feel free to connect on LinkedIn. Mm-hmm. I know that's a great networking. I'm always happy to answer questions. You can message me through there too.
Perfect. Thank you. I will be adding you on LinkedIn. You watch for me. I always look people up before.
Well, thank you for having me.
Yes, thank you. Have a great night, everyone.
Thank you.